Coming up on Harvest, a mouth-watering menu for meat lovers. I can smell the grill fired up right now. Troy DeShone is out there. He's going to be sizzling some ribeye steaks, some beef tender fillets, and asparagus that's done just right. Plus, change your words and change your life. Discover the secret to abundant blessing in six things believers need to say every day in today's Connections with Pastor Mark Lantz. And later on in the program, Middle East correspondent Brian Bush will join us with an update from the Old City in Jerusalem. So go ahead and get comfortable, kick back, because the Harvest Show starts right now. Hello and welcome to the Harvest Show. Yes, the weather outside is frightful, but the grill smells so delightful. A little bit of rain here today and much across the central part of the United States. We've had a lot of rain just across just the whole region, the nation as a whole, the Middle West especially. But glad you're joining us today, and trust wherever you're at, you're going to have a wonderful day. You guys doing well?
I'm doing well.
Ready for World Pulse Festival?
I am ready for World Pulse Festival.
Tomorrow night?
Tomorrow night, can't wait. Amy Grant, Michael W. Smith, and I'm looking forward to rocking on Saturday night with Building 429, Sidewalk Prophets, and so just
vertical
a whole
church band.
Vertical church band. I was trying to think of all the rockers, but it's going to be great. What about you? Earplugs?
Yes, I'll have my earplugs with me. I'm slightly distracted because, as you mentioned,
yes,
the smell coming from the grill right now is terrific, and I think that's just fresh zucchini on there right now. But
that's so not even the meat yet.
So anything that happens in this show, I'm not responsible for what I say, because
we'll
there could
the
be
news.
Drool coming out of my mouth during the news.
I ran into Angela on the way in this morning and said, "You ready for World Pulse Festival?" "Yeah, I'm ready to go. Everything's set." And she said, "Aren't you glad we're having it inside?" And I thought about that, because really today we'd be setting up the stage out in the back 40 there, and tomorrow night, you know, or Saturday would be people coming in. And thankfully, we don't have to worry about weather this year. So you can beat the heat, you can beat the rain, you can come on to the Compton Family Ice Arena for a great time on Friday and Saturday.
But we do have to worry about socks. Corey Mann has said, we need socks. Oh, hey, Pete.
I think you're making it obvious.
Oh, I didn't know.
Despite our attempts to be covert.
All right. There you go.
I'm trying to sneak in here a little late.
And I
thank
outed
you very,
him.
Yeah. I really appreciate that.
So we were just talking about that you need to wear socks for World Pulse Festival, because...
Yeah, flip-flops and shorts probably are not a good idea.
That's right. Yeah. Because
not
it's so
arena.
Cold in the building.
Yeah.
Okay, carry on.
Yeah. Hot in the it might be cold in the building, but it'll be hot in our hearts, and we're going to have a great time next couple nights. I want to touch on this article. Actually, you said it from the Wall Street Journal. You must have caught it when the website was just running, because yesterday... What a crazy day.
Yeah.
The stock market closed for close to 4 hours.
Right.
Thought it was a cyber, potential cybersecurity issues there. Turned out apparently it wasn't. But United Airlines grounding all flights.
All flights worldwide for over an hour.
For over an hour.
Wow.
And then Wall Street Journal's webpage was down for a while as well. And you think that's coincidental that all those things could be happening, or is something going on out there?
I've had some conversations this morning with people that think it's all totally coincidental. But being a little bit of a conspiracist myself, maybe United's problem was a technical issue, and maybe the Wall Street Journal problem was an overwhelming issue when the stock exchange went down. The stock exchange going down is really strange, because head of the stock exchange, the leadership there, has not said what happened, other than they did a software upgrade, they changed to a new server, and it didn't work. Come on. These people are pretty brilliant to put something online that in that case didn't work that bad.
Right.
So, did they hire the same company that was responsible for the rollout of Obamacare?
Probably.
Yeah, a Canadian firm.
Good point.
Yeah. But anyway, the article from WSJ was that there's a new gay rights push that's potentially going to find an uphill battle when it gets to Congress. But on the heels of the Supreme Court ruling, apparently there was a more than a year ago, gay rights advocates had laid out an agenda that if the Supreme Court were to legally institute same-sex marriage across the United States on a federal level, here's the plan of where we go from there to make sure that, you know, we have equal say and equal rights across the board. And so this particular push that will be introduced into Congress is an effort to enact federal legislation to prohibit discrimination in jobs, financial transactions, housing, and other aspects of public life. One of the alarming issues is that there's no variance for religious exemptions or exclusions or religious, you know, how does the First Amendment then maintain its integrity in the light of this kind of legislation?
And that's probably pretty scary. That's the worst part of that article for me. I absolutely believe there should be no discrimination whatsoever. But a religious organization should not have to hire someone who, frankly, doesn't believe or agree with the tenets of their belief.
Right.
There's a couple of cases like this that are going on right now. There's, for instance, some Christian colleges who are being told that they cannot stop a same-sex couple from having dormitory housing. That's a problem for some Christian colleges, obviously. Yeah, that's going to be a big deal. Yeah. Up in Canada, there is a Christian college that specializes in Christian-based law. They're being told they're not going to be accredited because they do not accept or condone homosexuality. So that if right now they're having to go through the accreditation process, and the Canadian government will not accredit the school because they don't condone homosexuality. So there's two or three big things that are going on right now, and this particular bill, I really doubt is going to pass, but to take away the religious exemption is going to be a major, major issue across a broad range of religious organizations.
I find it interesting that it's always the Christian colleges or the Christian employers that are approached, because Islam has some pretty solid fundamental teachings about homosexuality, which are very similar to the Christian teachings, and yet you never see the gay rights activists going after an Islamic bakery or an Islamic college or an Islamic employer, because I think they have a real fear of what would happen there. And, and meanwhile, the Christians, you know, because we're taught to turn the other cheek and to be meek and humble in many ways, are often approached. I would be curious to see how an Islamic employer would react to these kind of things.
You know, the story reminds me of what's unfolding right now in Florida. State Senator Scott Plakin has proposed a bill that would protect pastors. It's called the Pastors Protection Act, that so that when a pastor preaches what the Bible says about same-sex attraction or immorality, period, that this person would be protected under the law. Of course, gay rights advocates have said there's no need for that law, but we're seeing as this, you know, with this massive plan to kind of, you know, tackle each area of society so that we can normalize this. We see that happening right now. So I'm not so sure, you know, it'll be interesting to see how this unfolds. Maybe it may not happen right now, but I think we can look forward to this type of legislation, you know, throughout.
It seems like that's the way things are progressing. Just on, to finish up with this, Baylor University, this was news out this morning, no longer bans homosexual acts. And Baylor is the largest Baptist university in the United States, and they officially removed homosexual acts from their sexual conduct policy. So that in, from their statement, from Baylor University representative statement, said these changes were made because we didn't believe the language reflected Baylor's caring community. We are pleased with the recent changes to the policy language and that it states more plainly the expectations of the university. And now it again was an official statement from the nation's largest Baptist university. So
that's actually shocking.
It is shocking. It's a little bit unnerving to see, again, you know, the political pressure that's being put on the Christian community with respect to the homosexual agenda. So more on that. We'd love to hear your thoughts as well. Just chime in on Facebook, Twitter. You can email us live at LeSEA.com to share your thoughts as well. The international news is up next.
Now on this Thursday, July 9th, 2015, here's what's happening in your world. Shiite militiamen are making some progress in Iraq's Anbar province against Islamic State group militants. The militia used artillery and other arms during the fighting in Saqlawiya, 45 miles west of Baghdad. Most areas in that district are under IS control. More than 276,000 people have been displaced from Anbar province since it was captured by Islamic State extremists. Iraqi forces and allied Shiite militiamen have been struggling to claw back ground held by the IS in the Sunni province. Two Israeli citizens are being held in the Gaza Strip, at least one of them, by the Hamas militant group. Avraham Mengistu independently crossed the border fence into the Gaza Strip last year, nearly 2 weeks after the end of the Israel-Gaza war. Officials say Mengistu is being held against his will by Hamas. Senior Israeli government officials, speaking on condition of anonymity, said Israel had hoped keeping the affair quiet could lead to his release. The family had been instructed not to speak publicly about the matter. The second Israeli citizen being held in Gaza is an Arab citizen of Israel. There were no details given on his detention. Greek opposition leader Evangelos Mourakis met Greek President Prokopis Pavlopoulos in Athens today to discuss the ongoing bailout negotiations with the country's international creditors. We need more stories from the United States. Greece's government is racing to finalize a plan of reforms for its third bailout, hoping this time the proposal will get approval from its European partners and stave off a potentially catastrophic exit from the euro. Details of Greece's reforms must be submitted by Friday morning, giving time for creditors to review them ahead of a summit of the European Union's 28 members set for Sunday. Businesses and humanitarian organizations warn that the social and commercial damage now evident could become deeper and longer lasting if Greece and its creditors cannot finally come to terms. Analysts say they've been surprised by the effect that Greece has had on the world's stock markets in contrast to its overall economic size. Traders are calling for an end to the ongoing saga. Early trading indicates that European markets are optimistic this crisis will be resolved in a positive manner. Germany's DAX market is up nearly 2% today, and that follows the day's trend on other European trading floors. Markets in London and Paris are each up around 75 points. In fact, around the globe, the markets appear to be doing better today, but that's also due to a recovery in China. The Shanghai Stock Index is up about 6% today. That partially reverses a 30% drop over the last month. And commuters across London are struggling to cope with the effects of a 24-hour strike that has shut that city's underground system. There are long lines for buses, and many walked or cycled to work today during the morning rush hour. Road traffic far heavier than usual in London. Drivers and station staff are on strike in a dispute over pay and scheduling when a 24-hour underground service starts on some lines later this year. Still to come, our Middle East correspondent Brian Bush will give us an update from the Holy Land. But up next, Troy DeShone has fired up the grill, and boy, does he have some mouth-watering summer meals for the whole family. Look at those ribeyes, folks. We'll be right back after this.
Did you know that millions live in spiritual darkness seeking the Word of God? LeSEA Broadcasting is piercing the darkness 24 hours a day. The window of opportunity to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ has never been greater, but who knows when it will close. Join Partners in Faith today for as little as $25 a month, and you can help us bring light into a dark world. Join us by visiting partnerinfaith.com today.
The World Pulse Festival is coming up on Friday, July 10th and Saturday, July 11th at the Compton Family Ice Arena. You're all invited. It's a free ticket event, and you're going to love the artist lineup. Friday, it's Vertical Church Band. Amy Grant and Michael W. Smith. Saturday's lineup, it's Blanca, Sidewalk Prophets, 10th Avenue North, and you might remember this next band from last year, Building 429.
It's not about me, and you're all there will be.
Don't forget your free tickets. Don't forget about pre-parking. You can get your passes at worldpulsefestival.com. So we'll see you July 10th and 11th at the World Pulse Festival at Compton Family Ice Arena in South Bend, Indiana. Don't forget, free ticket info at worldpulsefestival.com.
In the last 15 years, friends like you have helped send over 700,000 Bibles to anyone who requests a copy through our Spread the Word ministry. God has certainly been working powerfully through your support. The book of Romans says, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." That's why we're so thankful for your partnership to help us take the best news of all time to more of those who are desperate to hear it. It costs just $5 to send a Bible to someone hungry to read it in Africa, South America, or many other places around the globe. Through your generosity, many thousands have already read about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And with your support, we look forward to helping fulfill Dr. Lester Sumrall's vision of reaching the untold billions yet untold with the gospel.
Well, it's true that I'll do anything for a ribeye steak. Welcome back to the Harvest Show. We're outside in the drizzling rain. You know, we had planned to do this grilling and barbecuing, so I've invited Troy DeShone. He's the owner, co-owner of Heine's Restaurant here in the area. And so we have some ribeye steaks grilling now.
We do. A couple of ribeyes and two beef tender fillets. Mm-hmm. Then we grilled up some zucchini and we've got mushrooms for the side.
Okay, so there's not much prep work that goes into this, I'd imagine, with these steaks, but how can we get these steaks as tender as possible?
Well, you can always take what's called a jacquard. Mm-hmm. Basically, it's a glorified fork and just pound them, and that kind of breaks everything down.
Tell me about your business at Heine's.
We're a steakhouse. You can get anything from grilled cheese to prime rib. Mm-hmm. And everything in between.
Okay, so I want to say that I'm not crying because I'm upset. This smoke is really doing a number on me. How long will we let the steaks grill? And I know that we have beef fillets as well.
They've been on for about five minutes. Mm-hmm. We'll probably keep them on for another five, and they should be about that medium well.
So when we start grilling, you know, for someone who says, "Oh, I want it medium well," about how long would that last?
Depending on the heat of the charcoal, it could go anywhere from 10 minutes all the way up to 20, 25.
Mm-hmm. And what about the vegetables you had to, they look perfect. I just want to grab one off the grill. So do you have to just, what?
Just
them cook for how long?
Yeah, we just lay them on the grill until they start getting a little soft and
whoa.
and the keep smoke's going to get
you
real bad.
Keep talking. Now, this is a family-owned business. I know that you and your brother are in business, and you have a couple other restaurants. Tell me about those restaurants.
Yeah, we have Maxie's, which is in South Bend, Indiana, mm-hmm. and then Stacy's, that is in Edwardsburg, Michigan. Mm-hmm. And I'm just using a little water to control the flame uh-huh. and smoke you out.
Listen, I will do anything for a good steak. That's not a problem. Let's talk about safety for the beginning griller, for a person who doesn't get out much and gets the chance to grill a lot. How do they get started? What would you say?
Oh, get yourself a decent gas grill, maybe charcoal if you like that flavor, and just keep it away from the house.
What do you specialize in at Heine's?
We specialize in steaks, obviously prime rib, and then hamburgers, tenderloins.
Tenderloins.
Oh my God, that is horrible.
So there's no way. What about pulling the lid down? Do you ever do that, or will it cause you to overcook?
I don't like to use a lid. A lot of people do, and mm-hmm. it will cook quicker. But I like making sure the flame is controlled.
Okay. So now, would it be okay if I got one of these vegetables off
you
the grill
help yourself?
Here? I'm just going to grab one. And how long should the vegetables cook?
We only cook them for about 3 or 4 minutes until they're soft.
Oh, it is so good. Chef Freebie is on his way. You have got to
I had to make sure that the building wasn't on fire.
Fire department
may be on their outside.
Maybe on their way. Just got to control the flame a little there.
Yeah, I know you're controlling the flames. Now, do you? And Troy, let's turn you around so that people can see your good side.
Not my bald spot.
Well, yeah. No, I'm trying to protect you because we're buds here. When you do vegetables on the grill, I noticed the hatch marks and everything. How long do you suggest grilling vegetables?
The thickness, so the thicker ones will take a little longer, but the thin ones get soft pretty quick. So you want to pull them while they're, you know, right at that sweet spot.
Now, we advertised asparagus earlier, and I'm not criticizing you for not having asparagus, but that is one of my favorites. And that's one that, as I recall, it doesn't really take that long to cook on the grill.
Maybe, oh, correct.
Maybe about, what, 2 or 3 minutes?
Yep, just a couple minutes to kind of cook through, and you've got no problem. We're going to add some mushrooms here.
And I see that you have a special sauce over there. What's that sauce?
That's just like an herb butter sauce. It's got things like.
Oh, there we go.
My mouth is literally watering right now.
Why don't I just take this one?
I'll let her munch on that little filet.
Wow, this looks so good. Now, is this medium well or well?
It should be right about the medium to medium well.
Oh.
And then these ribeyes will probably be closer to medium well.
Now, what about the mushrooms that you did here? You put those directly on the grill. I see you've got them in a container right now.
Mamma mia.
No, we cook those in a butter sauce with a little seasoned salt in them.
And came prepared.
It does a real nice job.
So that's something that somebody can do at home as well.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty easily.
Let me say this to you, Chuck. It is so tender that I used a butter knife to cut my beef into fillets.
That is awesome.
So tender, I used a butter knife. Look at that. For some reason, it never worked like that for me, though, at home.
For me? Mm-hmm. I didn't want to get hit by the flying debris there, but I did want to get in front of this ribeye steak.
I just want to taste a little of your steak.
What? Oh, yeah, we have to try chocolate.
Yes, we have to try this. Here, have some of my steak.
Oh, here, have some of my steak. Yeah, okay. Meanwhile, I'll be stealing yours. You know, I read somewhere in a magazine that that's where most fights in restaurants occur, is people stealing food
steak
off of each other's plate. Actually, it's over the French fries.
Over the French fries.
Here here's another ribeye. Now,
folks at home. That's for you, friends.
I have, Pastor Charles was wandering around out here too, so you might as well come over here, Pastor Charles. And the best thing about Pastor Charles today is he's not mic'd up, so we won't be hearing from him. No, I'm just teasing. Look at this tie that Pastor Charles has on today, the Screaming American Eagle. You're a little late for the 4th of July, my friend, but that's okay.
That's okay.
But I want to get Troy back over here. And Troy, I've been to your restaurant before. I know people come in for the steaks and everything else, but
yeah.
Your specialty, what you're known for over in Elkhart at your restaurant, is something called the Heine Burger, which, you know, on the surface sounds like a funny thing. But
yeah.
when people do burgers on the grill, mm-hmm. what's the biggest mistake they typically make?
Flipping them too many times and pushing them down and squeezing all the juice out of it.
Okay, so squeezing all the juice out. But you say flipping them too many times, I want to make sure it doesn't get overdone. What do I have to do?
Just, you know, let them cook to the point to where they're not burnt and, you know, flip them as least many times as you can.
Well, I know that really point blank fat makes a good burger. So what cuts of beef should we use when we're grilling a hamburger? I know it sounds like a simple question, but.
Right, we use an 80-20 mix.
Okay.
That gives it a lot of the good flavor. Mm-hmm. Probably not as good for you as what the, you know, 95% is, but.
Let me ask a follow-up question, because people have this as well. What kind of steak should I put on the burger?
Yeah.
Sometimes you go and you get something like a chuck and you flip, and it's not meant to be grilled.
Right. You can get anything from sirloin to the black Angus. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the better the beef, the more flavor you're gonna have.
Awesome. Well, my mouth's full in a minute.
Well, I'm speechless because I'm just blown away by how tender this is. So did you tenderize it? Did you let it sit in the refrigerator a day or two with some special herbs on it or something?
No, a lot of people will marinate overnight. We don't do that at the restaurant because we don't have that type of time. We have our butter sauce and we have seasonings in that. Mm-hmm. But the beef tenders, you just can't go wrong with them. They're usually always very tender. Mm-hmm. And we always get the black Angus.
So really it sounds like the philosophy is keep it as simple as possible.
Correct. Yep.
What about chicken and fish? What are some tricks or some things that people have to watch out for on that?
Chicken, you definitely want to make it, you know, get it as well done as you can. There's just a small window of opportunity where it's still juicy inside, but it's but it is done. You know, you want to bake out all
the bad stuff. You don't want underdone chicken.
No. Oh, God, no.
Should you use a meat thermometer then, or how should you make sure it's done?
Yep. You can probe the breast, and I believe it's 165, I believe.
165 for chicken. And then on fish, any tricks there?
We always just kind of take our tongue and open the fish up just a little bit, make sure there's no pink in the salmon and what other type of fish. But unless it's tuna or something like that, you probably want it well done.
Now, when you're working with chicken, I know you have to be really careful. So what are some of the things that we should do to make sure we don't contaminate the other food?
Definitely. Well, we're required to wear gloves and wash our hands constantly. Mm-hmm. But anything that the chicken touches, the plates, you want to get washed right away and don't put your cooked food on the
same
plate.
Something that had raw on it. Yep.
Cool. Very good. Troy DeShone. Valerie's responsibilities for doing this interview have just gone right out the window here, apparently. So I'll close things up. Troy, thank you very much for joining
us. Thank you for having me.
Troy DeShone from Heine's Restaurant over in Elkhart, Indiana. As he mentioned, they also have Maxie's in South Bend and Stacy's in Edwardsburg. Terrific food. If you need some grilling tips or find out how to do this, make sure you check out our webpage at harvest-tv.com. Coming up, Pastor Mark Lantz has those six words that you need to say every day as a Christian. Mm-hmm. We've got that coming up in today's Connections after this.
Pete Summerall has always shared his father's lifelong vision to save the lost. So over the summer months of June and July, LeSEA Broadcasting is praying fervently that God will bring in a bountiful global summer harvest. To sustain vital ministries that are now reaching countless millions of people, LeSEA must receive $331,000 in the next 60 days. Please send your June gift today. Call LeSEA Broadcasting at 1-800-365-3732. That's 1-800-365-3732. When's the last time you described your vacation as unforgettable and life-changing? As a Christian, one of the most meaningful journeys you'll ever take is a visit to the Holy Land. Since 1965, the ministry of LeSEA Tours has been privileged to change the lives of thousands of people by providing meaningful and exciting trips to Israel. A visit to the Holy Land with LeSEA Tours is a vacation you will actually experience. You'll walk the same path that Jesus took with the cross, get baptized in the Jordan River, sail on the Sea of Galilee, and step back in time as you visit a first century village in Nazareth, pray at the Western Wall, float in the lowest spot on earth, and get your hands dirty by planting your own tree. But most importantly, you'll experience the land that God chose for His home here on earth, and you'll never be the same. LeSEA Tours travels with you to Israel every February, June, and November since 1965. Call today to receive a free information packet or visit on the web at leseatours.com.
These days, reading your Bible is as easy as opening an app on your phone or doing a quick internet search. But how do people in developing countries hear the gospel when they don't have access to television, the internet, or Christian publications? The answer for many is shortwave radio. Technology that's accessible to millions and ideal for broadcasting God's word to areas where missionaries simply cannot reach or aren't permitted to travel. We're so thankful for your support, which has helped continue the work Dr. Lester Summerall began 70 years ago. Through your gifts and prayers, we continue to transmit God's word to every major continent in the world through shortwave radio, helping to reach a potential 20 million homes through this powerful technology. Through the support of friends like you, the good news of Jesus continues to be heard by many living in the most difficult to reach corners of the globe. And we thank you.
Well, we're talking about six things that believers need to say every day. And the reason we're talking about this is because we understand the power and the control that our words have over our world. So the third thing that I want you to focus on is to intentionally, daily, speak words that edify, that encourage those around you. Look at this scripture in Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 4, where the Bible said, "The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary." I love that statement. The tongue of the learned has the right word for those who are weary. You see, you have an incredible opportunity every single day to edify, to build up the people who are around you. Stop and think about the people that you work with every day. Even the most negative or the most pessimistic people who are around you. Did you ever stop to think that there may be a reason that they live in such pessimism? Maybe there's issues going on in their life right now of which you might not be aware. Maybe they're going through a divorce, or quite possibly a loved one is sick, or maybe they're dealing with a sense of low self-esteem. I believe so many times we as believers are far too quick to judge others when we really don't know what is going on in their life. And I'm telling you that today, rather than judge and be critical of them, ask the Holy Spirit to give you a word that will encourage them, a word that will build them up, will edify them. What a great opportunity you have today to build someone through a word that just may change their life. But you must be intentional. And also, you must be encouraged yourself before you can encourage anybody else. I love this passage in 1 Samuel chapter 30, speaking of David, where he was greatly distressed. And the people were speaking of stoning him because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But look at this statement here. David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. No matter what is going on in your life right now, you and I need to learn to encourage ourselves in the Holy Spirit. Because then when I'm encouraged, I will then have the ability to encourage those who are around me. Jude spoke in verse 20 of his epistle. He said, "Beloved, build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Edify, build yourself up." The fourth thing that you need to speak every day is this: speak words of truth. I know that sounds simple, maybe sounds elementary, but you'd be surprised how many believers stretch the truth when they speak, or they speak words that are half-truths rather than solid truth. Jesus told us in John chapter 8, he said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." There is nothing that will keep a person in more bondage than speaking words that are not entirely true. Your mind's going to be plagued by the fact that you didn't tell your spouse maybe why you came home late from work last week, or maybe you're going to be haunted by the fact you were not entirely truthful on your tax return, or maybe you covered up your sin by blaming somebody else for what you did and then made an excuse for your sin. Here's the deal. True freedom comes when you own up to the truth. If you messed up, admit it. If you made a mistake, admit it. Don't try to cover up what you've done or who you are by telling some story that's not entirely based in truth. We as believers must be people of 100% truth. Proverbs 23, the wise man Solomon said, "Buy the truth and sell it not, also wisdom, instruction, and understanding." To be very frank with you today, telling the truth will cost you something. It may cost you your job when you're instructed to do something that goes against your biblical convictions. But if you stand up and you speak the truth, it will cost you something. It may cost you a relationship when you're tempted to compromise your sexual purity and say no to that offer. If you are committed to the truth, my friend, believe me when I say that the enemy's going to bring situations into your life that will try to sway you from that truth. But I encourage you today, hang on to the truth. No matter what, no matter what it costs you, it will be worth it in the end. Speak words of truth. Your life, the life of those around you, will be free because it's truth that makes you free. And I feel like I'm speaking to someone right now. You have been tempted to compromise, and the Lord is saying, stand firm. Speak the truth. Speak it in love, but speak the truth.
and let the truth redeem you and set you free. Six things believers need to say every day. Speak these words, see your world change forever.
You know, it occurs to me that biblical words like vows and commitments and pledges have somehow lost their meaning in today's culture. But we expect God to keep His promises to us, so why shouldn't He expect us to keep ours? Keeping a promise isn't always easy. Sometimes it requires us to take bold steps of faith. Dr. Lester Sumrall said, when you walk in the faith realm, you must accept the Word of God or you won't make it. For example, God said, if you make a vow to the Lord your God, you shall not delay fulfilling it, for the Lord your God will surely require it of you, and you will be guilty of sin. And again he said, when you vow a vow to God, do not delay paying it. It is better you should not vow than that you should vow and not pay. God will always honor his promises to you. Remember to always honor your promises to him.
Welcome back to Harvest. Earlier in our newscast, we told you about two Israelis who are being held in Gaza. Well, let's get in depth on that story right now and go over to our LeSEA correspondent, Brian Bush, who joins us now from Jerusalem. And Brian, as we take a look at this story, I'm sure many of our viewers are hoping this doesn't wind up being a repeat of what was a five-year saga for Israel.
Well, yes, indeed, Chuck, and you're referring to the Israeli soldier Gilad Shalit, who was held for 5 years by Hamas in the Gaza Strip. It has been released for publication today that two Israelis are currently being held by Hamas in Gaza. One was at first described as an Ethiopian Israeli soldier, Avra Mengistu. He's 28 years old. He entered Gaza just a couple of weeks or so after the conclusion of Operation Protective Edge last summer. The other is a Bedouin Israeli citizen who frequently crossed into Gaza and has apparently now been abducted. Chuck?
Brian, do we know for sure if these people are alive? I mean, I assume they must be if there's so much attention now being given to their case.
Well, Chuck, that's the working assumption by the security sources, but there has been no sign of life. According to Hamas, the person which they held in custody was interrogated and then released, but the Israeli Defense Forces reject this claim as they see it as an attempt by Hamas to dodge responsibility for the man's welfare. Because there are some reports, and this is a developing story, that he has a mental condition. And this is where things get a little confusing, because supposedly the IDF did not draft him because of his illness. Chuck?
Well, and Gaza has been a sore spot for the IDF over the years. They've got another issue brewing from last summer's conflict with Hamas, where Israeli soldiers may have actually killed one of their own in a heated operation in Gaza.
This, too, is a developing story right now, Chuck. The issue here is that it evolves around what is called the Hannibal procedure, something that the Israeli Defense Forces have incorporated into their warfare during Operation Protective Shield last summer in Gaza, which is a series of radical actions aimed at preventing the capture of a fellow soldier. It has come out that Israel used this procedure, and they may have their actions taken may have resulted in the captured soldier being killed by the IDF to prevent his abduction. Now, the action allows for aggressive, risk-taking, invasive measures to save the captured soldier. It does not at all look at this point like the soldier died from a deliberate, ordered action, but rather a breakdown in the implementation and understanding of what the Israeli soldiers may have in fact done or were allowed to do when they were trying to prevent the abduction of the soldier that resulted in his death. Chuck?
Brian, as we have today, we often use this segment not only to look at Israel, but at all things in the Middle East. We talked about Iraq in the news. And I understand you wanted to share an interesting development concerning this conflict in Syria that really hasn't been widely reported on.
Yes, indeed, Chuck, and thank you for the opportunity. And this is that the government of Brussels says some 240 people, mainly Christians, have been removed from Syria's second largest city of Aleppo and taken to Belgium. This was done because families are fleeing the area, fleeing their homes because of the repeated human rights abuses there. Before the war, Aleppo had a Christian population of around 160,000, one of the biggest in the Middle East. That's more, in fact, than the total of the number of Christians living here in Israel. Now, this operation took place over a two-month period of time and was kept in secrecy because the only way to get these people out of Syria, which also included Yazidis, I should say, was an open road from Aleppo to the Lebanese border, and they had to do things very slowly and sporadically as not to draw attention to the process. Chuck?
Wow, Brian, amazing for those people to get out of there, and we certainly a terrific reminder to all of us that we have to continue to pray for our Christian brethren in the Middle East who are going through so much difficulty right now. Here in the United States, we think that Christians are being persecuted because of some political developments, but this is actual life and death persecution going on in the Middle East, and certainly we invite you to pray for our brethren there. Brian has a blog. It is available on Facebook. Sometimes people say they have a little difficulty getting to it, but the main thing you have to do, see where the cursor is circling around? Hit that button, the like button, and that'll give you everything you need. And then right there is Brian's latest video blog. And he will also be with us tomorrow on Harvest, so we look forward to a rare Friday report from our friend Brian Bush in the Middle East. Now, coming up this weekend, it's the World Pulse Festival, 29th annual event. This one will be at the Compton Family Ice Arena, and we are so excited about tomorrow night because we've got Michael W. Smith, one of the great Christian performing artists, joining us. Here he is with one of his old-time favorites, a song called Healing Rain.
Healing rain is coming down. It's coming nearer to this old town. Rich and poor, weak and strong, it's bringing mercy. It won't be long. Thank you.
World Pulse Festival, Friday, July 10th and Saturday, July 11th.
The World Pulse Festival.
Featuring your favorite Pulse FM artists at the Compton Family Ice Arena at Notre Dame.
Friday night.
It's the Vertical Church Band and your co-headliners, Michael W. Smith and Amy Grant.
Saturday night.
It's Sidewalk Profits, Building 429 and 10th Avenue North. Get your ticket information at worldpulsefestival.com. Put it on your calendar and we'll see you this summer at the World Pulse Festival.
Many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim his message of God's love to the villages and streets he walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith for as little as $25 a month. Call today.
Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
If you are among the thousands who love the teaching of Lester Sumrall, then you should have the two-volume set of The Treasury of Lester Sumrall. Written in Dr. Sumrall's easy-to-understand style, you'll feel like you are getting a Bible school education. There are 732 individual readings, one for each day for 2 whole years. These beautiful devotionals will also make a wonderful gift for your friends, family, or even your pastor. Order yours today.
It is not too late for you to become a part of the Global Summer Harvest campaign to help us take the gospel around the world. As you can see there, we're doing it through Spread the Word Bible, Middle East Television, and Shortwave Radio, and 24-hour prayer line. We have a goal of $331,000 that we need to meet before July the 31st or on July the 31st, but we need your help. And here's what we're doing. We're taking the gospel around the world. And we need volunteers, we need donors, we need people who love God to come alongside us to help us accomplish that goal. Because, Stephan, I mean, you've been to other countries, you've seen where people have those Bibles that you take when you take with Feed the Hungry, and those kids hold those Bibles up, and that's a result of people calling in saying, yes, I'll be a part of the campaign.
Yeah, and it's really a powerful thing to see the impact that the Word of God makes. I mean, these are brothers and sisters in Christ who would not have no hope of having a Bible they could call their own were it not for someone bringing it to them. Some places the Bibles are just not available. Other places they're available, but it takes a 2 weeks, 3 weeks worth of an income to get a Bible. And when you're living on $1 to $2 a day, you just don't have that disposable income, you know, when you're considering putting a roof over the head for your family, feeding your family. And so these Bibles make a huge, huge impact. And the look of joy on people's faces when they receive them, man, forget $5. It's worth $5,000.
It's priceless.
To see that and to know that the Word of God being planted in the hearts of the children, in the hearts of the families that receive these Bibles, it will never, never return void, but it will produce great, great harvest and fruitfulness in their lives.
Well, and certainly their ability to look at the Word of God, to comprehend the Word of God is great, but I always go back to that story that we learned earlier this year, the man in Uganda who was the only one in his village who had received a Bible and was starting a church. So there's a Bible that's not just producing fruit in one person, it's going to wind up producing fruit throughout that entire village as he learns how to preach the Word of God. But we need your help to make these things happen. Can't do them by ourselves. That's why we ask you to become a partner with us at LeSEA Broadcasting to go and tell the untold billions yet untold. And you can do it easily by going to 1-800-365-3732 or by going online at LeSEA.com. If you prefer to do your financial transactions without the interaction of another person, that's okay. You can do that live at LeSEA.com. Earlier, before we came to this segment, we saw a spot from our friend Dr. Harold Hazen talking about the Treasury of Lester Sumrall, and I did want to share something with our viewers and listeners today from the Treasury of Dr. Sumrall, because he talks about joy and pain, and I think it's very relevant given the things that are in the news today to hear what Dr. Sumrall has to say, because he says as Christians we have the joy of knowledge of fulfilled prophecy. It makes us know that the Word of God is true. It brings a fountain of joy into our hearts. And when we see terrible things take place, as are happening throughout the world today, we don't throw ourselves into the dust and say it's all over. We lift up our heads as Jesus told us to do. We should think of the joy of fulfilled prophecy each and every day. We hear of wars here and uprisings there, and others are cast down, but we are not. We lift up our heads and we rejoice, for we are getting close to home. We are almost at the door. Our journey is almost over. But there is also the pain of fulfilled prophecy. When Jesus experienced the stripes spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, he was feeling the pain of fulfilled prophecy. On that day he was born, there was a tree growing from which his cross would be made. Never thought of that before, but it's true. On the day Jesus was born, somewhere there's a tree growing that would someday become his cross. Jesus was always conscious of divine destiny. He would often say, "It has happened to me as it is written to fulfill prophecy." It's wonderful to live with a destiny. We can endure anything if we have a consciousness that God wants us to do it. No waters are too deep, no mountains are too high, no plains are too wide, if I know that Jesus is the one who wants me to go. And then the little passage here closes by saying, "Don't let the news bring fear into your life. Instead, rejoice, for it is prophecy being fulfilled before your eyes."
You know, when I think of that, you know, you do the news here on the Harvest mm-hmm. Show, international news, and you could easily become cynical after watching all of that. But I'd imagine that when you're doing the news, you understand that God is in control of everything.
Well, one thing that I take heart in is I know when I was hired here 11 years ago now, I was told that there was a group of nuns somewhere that would pray as they watched our newscast, and mm-hmm. they would pray over the news and the events of the news that we were talking about. And they would pray for the people that were wow. victims or their families or things like that. And I think that's good advice for all of us as we hear the events of the news to pray about, to turn it back to God and say, God, we may not understand why this is happening, but we know who's in control, and it's you, and we're turning things over to you. And we truly believe God is in control. We'll have more news for you tomorrow, and you'll get to choose your news on tomorrow's Harvest.
Pete Summerall has always shared his father's lifelong vision to save the lost. So over the summer months of June and July, LeSEA Broadcasting is praying fervently that God will bring in a bountiful global summer harvest. To sustain vital ministries that are now reaching countless millions of people, LeSEA must receive $331,000 in the next 60 days. Please send your June gift today. To send your June gift today, visit LeSEA Broadcasting online at LeSEA.com. LeSEA.com.
Do you sometimes wonder what life would be like if you had the energy to do those extra things you want to do but just can't? Maybe it's to go for a walk after dinner or spend your Saturdays playing with your kids. If you're tired all the time and have decided that you just always will be, guess what? You don't have to be. With Mineral Concentrate from Making Healthy Choices, this fulvic acid electrolyte mineral formula promotes maximum cell function while sparking your body's electrical conductivity. What does that mean? Well, most people say they've never felt better. The best part is it's only $29.95. And if you call now, we'll even pay to ship it to you. So dial 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com. This electrolyte formula promotes dependable, solid energy day in and day out. So call the number on the screen. Do it for your spouse, your kids, your friends, and most of all, do it for you. Call 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com. It's time for life.
The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.